Welcome.
Lord Jesus, I thank you for this day. I thank you for waking us up this morning, oh God. I thank you for all the things that you have done in our lives, oh God. I thank you for keeping us safe during this time, oh God. And Lord Jesus, I ask that you would just help us right now. And Lord, take us through this day. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Psalm 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod, thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me for all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever."
I'll be reading Romans 12, 1-3.
I beseech you, get for bothering by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. For I gave through the great given unto me, to every man gathered among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly according to God hath given to every man the measure of faith.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We'll sigh. Let the praise singers sing and say, for he is good. He is good. Thank you, Jesus. When I have a headache, he's good. When I have money, he's good. When I don't have anybody, he's still good. In other words, God is good all of the time. Hallelujah. We praise God for his goodness on today on behalf of our pastor, the Superintendent Roy Riley, Senior, and the Jerusalem Temple, the church with the great big heart. Thank you, Jesus. We are just so happy that you're part of our services today. And as I oftentimes say, we're especially excited about our virtual audience. We are excited about you, our virtual audience. And we want you to know that we love you. God loves you, and we love you also. Today is Youth Day, and we praise God for those individuals who get our youth ready and who are training our youth. Praise the Lord. We're so happy that we have some youth here who come to church and who praise God. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give all you a hand. Hallelujah. We want our youth to know that we are proud of you. We are proud of you, our youth. We are proud of you. And we want you to go forward. We know that if you stay with the Lord is going to take you higher. There's no telling where God will take you if you stay with him. Once again, come on, church. Let's give our gift to heaven. Hallelujah. We are proud of our youth. We want you to know that all youth are not in the streets. Some youth go to church. And we are proud of our youth. We are proud of our leaders, the Elder James Dixon, and those that work with him, working with our youth. Hallelujah. We thank God once again for the youth. And we want our virtual audience and those of you that are here, get into the service. Don't just look at our youth. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We want you to get into the service. We want to encourage them on today to continue with the Lord. At this time, I believe our praise team is coming back. Let's get with the praise team and our youth.
Stand up with us and we'll pray for today. right, Hosanna. Our youth department is coming with a short presentation. It's Hosanna. Let's say amen for them.
Thank you.
part.
Keep it going. I will bless. Your name, oh God. Hallelujah. Oh God, we bless you. Hallelujah. Oh, we bless your name. You are mighty God. You are good God. Hallelujah. You are wonder in our souls. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, we bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Wonderful God. Hallelujah. 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 Oh God, we bring you a sacrifice of praise on today. We bless your name, oh God. There is none like you. There is none beside you. We worship your name, oh God. You're our creator, God. You're our friend. You're our way out of no way. And we bless your name. Hallelujah. We give you praise, oh God. Hallelujah. We worship you in the beauty of holiness. Hallelujah. 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 God, sweep over our souls on today. Somebody say, sweep over my soul. Sweep over my soul. God, we need you to sweep over our souls. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to your name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's a song says that there is no God like Jehovah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There is no God like Jehovah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, glory to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory to your name, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to your name, God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We've got a song that the angels can't sing. We've been redeemed. We've been redeemed, hallelujah, out of the hands of the enemy. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. God is good. Hallelujah. And we thank God for his presence on today. Oh, God, we thank you for your presence on today. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen and amen, amen. Glory to God. We thank God on today for, we don't say it a lot, but we thank God for the singers on today. Amen. You all don't see the same singers all the time, but they're always working. The singers are always there, and we thank God for them leading in the presence of the Lord. We thank God. Amen. We thank God for the musicians. Hallelujah. Thank God for them. Amen. Thank God for Minister McCullough playing skillfully on the bass. His son DJ on the drums. Amen. We thank God for, we thank God for Davion on today. Davion is mainly who you see on the drums, but he takes a break and allows DJ to play sometimes. We thank God for him. Amen. We thank God for each of you on today. Hallelujah. God is good. God is good, and it's a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. I was glad when they said unto me, let us what? Say it again. Let us what? Hallelujah. Let us go into the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. The word of God says that our inheritance are among those that are sanctified. Hallelujah. And it sure is. I feel like I got something on today. Hallelujah. Your inheritance is what your Father has for you. And when we can partake of the goodness of God, we are receiving our inheritance. Glory to God. Amen. We always focus on the material riches, but there are spiritual riches as well. Hallelujah. Thank God for your presence on today. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's make some noise for our youth on today. Woo! Glory to God. We're training them up in the way that they should go. Amen. We thank God for them, for their parents, grandparents, aunties, and uncles, all of those who support. We thank God for our virtual audience on today. Amen. And we don't want to forget our leaders. Let's make some noise for them. Woo! Come on, y'all can do better than that. All right, we thank God for our pastor and first lady on today. Amen. Glory to God. Thank God for them. And I'm going to go quickly into the word of God on today. We're going to go to Mark chapter 2. We're going to go to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2, and we'll be reading a few verses from there. Glory to his name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We're going to read verses 1 through 5. We're going to read verses 1 through 5. Yes, ma'am. Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2. Let's go ahead and read 1 through 11. I'll go ahead and read them. I'll read verses 1 through 11 right quickly. I know it's a lot of verses, but I want to make sure we get the context. Mark chapter 2, starting at verse 1. And again, he entered in Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was in the house. And straightway many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them. And they come unto him, bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born afore. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, Why doth this man thus speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God only? In his spirit, while they so reason within themselves, he said unto them, Why reason ye these things in your hearts? Whether is it easier to say to the sick of the palsy, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Arise, and take up thy bed and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins, he saith to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, Arise, and take up thy bed, and go thy way into thine house. Last scripture, verse 12, And immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went forth before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, We never saw it on this fashion. So Jesus is preaching at this time. He's preaching in somebody's house, and he's drawing a good crowd. And the house is so full that nobody else can get in. So you have these four guys carrying another guy, and he's sick of the palsy. He's sick in his body, and they're trying to get him to Jesus, but they cannot. So the word of God says that they went to the extreme. Thank you. The word of God says that they went to the extreme, and they went on the roof, and they tore the roof up and let their friend down. And the word of God says that Jesus saw their faith. He saw their faith. And this man got his healing because his friends went out of the way to get him to Jesus. And I want to focus on that thing today. I want you to, and this is what the word of God is saying to us today, tear it up to get to Jesus. Somebody say, tear it up. Say it again, tear it up. There are some things that will block us and that will hinder us from getting to Jesus. And we need to make sure that we tear some things up. Now, a lot of times we look to God to tear some things up for us. We need God to make the crooked places straight. We need God to smooth out the rough spots so we can get to him. But sometimes that burden will be upon us. I was telling young people this morning that, you know, God has, when he saves us, he cleans us up. He makes us a brand new creature, puts his spirit inside of us. We're a brand new person, but God cannot live our lives for us. When it comes to hindrances, when it comes to roadblocks, obstacles, God can't come down to us and make us walk through those obstacles. He can't get us to press through the things that are hindering us. We have to do that. Now, God can strengthen us. He can. Well, after God strengthens us, it is upon us to use that strength. When the Bible says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, it says, I can do. But sometimes we want God to do and we want him to strengthen. God, I need you to send me your strength. Now I need you to walk for me. No, we need to walk. The song says, walk with me. It didn't say walk for me. It says while I'm on this Christian journey or tedious journey, I want you to walk with me. We are doing the journey. So we need to tear up some things. And one thing that is real big that I'm going to start off with is us. We need to tear up ourselves. I know that might sound kind of unusual, but we need to tear ourselves up. Because we are in the way of us getting to the Lord sometimes. We can get in the way. Have you ever heard that phrase that we are our own worst enemy? That is true. Sometimes, and this is something that I even struggle with. Sometimes, you know, have you ever made a mistake and you call yourself something because you made a mistake? Has anybody ever said that? I mean, I used to go as far as just say, you idiot. You know, and sometimes you get used to doing that. And God had to tell me about that. Why are you talking down to yourself? Why are you downing yourself? Does God call you an idiot because you messed up? If God looked down on us for when we messed up, it would be hard for us to come to him, wouldn't it? It would be hard. And sometimes we get in our own way. We discourage our own selves. The word of God says, come unto me, all you who are heavy laden and heavily burdened, and I will give you rest. Sometimes we stop ourselves from going to him. This mistake is too big. I can never go back. I messed up too bad. I can never go back. My situation is too bad. I have to remain here and suffer in my situation. I have this sickness in my body. I have this condition, and I have to just suffer with it because I just have to deal with it. It will never change. Did God ever say that? Does the word of God say that your situation will never change? He said, I will give you rest. I will give you rest. I will change your things around. I will change your life around. The children were singing a song today, Waymaker. It didn't say that I'm a waymaker only when it's the easiest for me to do. He didn't say I'm just a waymaker when it's something simple like a headache. He didn't say when it's only when you need a few dollars for your financial needs. He said, I'm a way maker, period. The word of God asks a question, is there anything too hard for the Lord? Is there anything too hard for God? And the answer is no. So why do we stop ourselves? Because listen, somebody can discourage you. Somebody can say something mean to you. But it's on us to decide if we're going to let that discouragement stop us from getting to God. Somebody can say to you, well, you know, I had a sibling. I had somebody in my family who suffered what you went through, and they just had to deal with it. And, you know, they're not with us today. And, no, you hear things like that, and it gets to you like, well, I guess I'm just going to have to deal with it. But God didn't say that. God didn't say that. I just heard somebody say, by his stripes. By his stripes, we are what? Healed. And that's not just physically. That is emotionally. That is mentally. That is spiritually. By his stripes, we are healed. And it says that in the present, we are healed. And somebody might be wondering, well, if I'm healed, why is it that I'm going through this? Why is it that I feel a certain way in my body? Why is that? And my pastor always teaches us that faith is not a feeling. Faith is not based on what you feel. And he asked the question, how do you know that you're healed? Somebody may say, well, because I feel better. That's not why you're healed. You're healed because the word of God says we're healed, and our faith is in the word of God. Amen? Our faith is in the word of God. It's not based on how we feel. Love is not a feeling. Sometimes we get so wrapped up in our emotions, and I'm still dealing with us. Sometimes our emotions can be a hindrance. I don't feel like they love me. I feel like they don't like me. I feel like this church doesn't like me. I feel like they don't love me. But what does God say? Did God tell you to love that person? Did God tell you that that person is the one for you? Sometimes it can be our spouse. I feel like my spouse doesn't love me. But are you going to let your feelings stop you from loving somebody else? Are we going to let our feelings stop us from walking in what the Word of God tells us is the truth? We cannot let us stop us. Because if we want to receive the Word of God, I'm telling you that the enemy is going to try and tempt your flesh with everything he can imagine. If he has to use people, he'll use it. If he has to use money, if he has to use the cares of this world, he will use it. And if he has to use you, he will use you. Don't let the devil use you to stop yourself. That is one of the worst things. When we stop ourselves from receiving all that God has for us. So we need to tear up ourselves. Tear ourselves up. Jesus said that if any man will come after me, he must first deny himself. Tear it up. Deny yourself so you can get to God. I just don't understand why I have to do this. I don't understand why my pastor asked us to fast. Get over yourself. Tear it up. Get over yourself. If you want something from God, you need to get over yourself. I need to get over myself. I just don't understand why I got to give up my hamburgers. We're supposed to be having a company lunch today, man. Some color. Y'all know the struggle is real. Y'all done went through it. Somebody come over to your house with a dozen donuts. Now, you know I'm fasting today. Why would they do that? Devil and somebody, yeah, that's right. Just start casting out. The devil is a liar. Make them donuts smell extra good today. That chicken be so powerful. Like, I never smell chicken like this while I'm fasting. He'll do it. He'll intensify that smell just to get you off of what you're supposed to be doing. And that's with any temptation. The devil will just make it extra strong. Like, I just don't get it. Seems like that person that you're not supposed to be dealing with would just pursue you the more. That person is not supposed to be in my life. That is not who God has for me. And it seems like they're just coming after me extra hard. It doesn't matter how hard the devil may come, you continue to resist. Amen. Don't allow him to stop you from getting to God. He will use somebody that may just be the most beautiful person. And I can attest to this. It may seem like, yes, that is them for me. But then God will show you some things like, that's not right. That's not right. That's not right. I can't. That's not right. And you may have to go your separate way. And then when we ignore what God is saying, it'll blow up in your face. And I'm saying this from personal experience. You ignore what God is telling you, and it will blow up in your face. And we don't want that to happen because God, I'm telling you, God would say over and over again, he says, destruction doesn't come without a warning. He warns us over and over again, well, I'm just going to have to, I know that's the person for me. I'm just going to have to deal with it. No, God is warning you for a reason. Sometimes we have to tear up relationships in order to get further in God. Sometimes we have to tear up relationships for us to go further in God. Relationships can hinder what we have and what we receive from God. And yes, it is a hard thing to tear up relationships, especially if you've been in a relationship for a while. Now listen, I'm not talking to married people. I had to say that. Virtual audience. Jerusalem Temple, I'm not talking about married people. I just don't feel this the wife that God has for me. What God has joined together, let no man put asunder. So if you are married, you stay with your spouse. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, don't use what I'm saying. All right, he told me this. Sometimes I got to cut relations. Lord, I want to grow in you. I'm sorry. There's this other more beautiful lady that God has. So no, don't use that as an excuse. Don't do that. Don't do that. Amen. Now, if something is going on with our spouse and our relationship, our marriage, we want to see God that both of us grow. Because listen, sometimes people get it messed up that I am me and my spouse is them. But the word of God says that we are one flesh. We are one. So I had to get over on that we are one. If we are married, we are one. So we're not just trying to grow as an individual in marriage. We're trying to grow together in God. Amen? Sometimes a spouse may get saved and that other spouse is not saved. But our desire is that our husband or wife be saved so that we can grow together. Amen? Amen. So talking to those who are not married, sometimes we're going to have to cut relationships if it's not the will of God for us. And I'm speaking through experience. That relationship I had to be cut. It had to be torn up. And I didn't tear it up. God tore it up. God blew it up in my face. Tore it up. Had no reason but to cut it off. And if I would have continued, I would have been foolish. And when God blows something up, we can all say if God blows up, then I know that. But some people still continue with it. God will show us and we will still continue in something and it will drive us down. There are people in relationships that the devil is using that relationship to tear them down. Amen? And we don't want to use anything, let anything tear us down because listen, if we're going down and down and down and down, we can't see Jesus because we're just on our way down. We have to look up. We have to look up. We have to realize, and this is a decision we have to make. We have to look up and say, I need God. And young people, that is something that we have to realize. That's something that you have to realize. You need God. And young people, I know that right now, some young people, you have it made. You have a mother and a father or a grandmother, a grandfather, auntie, or uncle that is providing for you, and they're doing a great job. And you are not lacking in anything. You have the money you need. You have the food you need. You have the clothes you need. And something may come to you. Well, what do I need God for? What do I need God for if I have everything I need already? It is because of God that you have what you have. The word of God says that it is in him that we live, move, and have our being. Everything that we have is because of God, whether you give him credit or not. Everything we have is because of God. Even the sinner has what they have because of God. The word of God says he reigns on the just and the unjust. He woke us all up this morning. And young people, I want to encourage you. Despite what you feel, you don't have to wait until you absolutely need God. We need him, but you have to recognize that you need him. And young people, I want to encourage you. The word of God says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him. Whatever you have doesn't compare to having a relationship with our Almighty God. And that's why I encourage you to encounter God. Seek God so that you can have your own experience with him. Don't just let it be your testimony that my parent took me to church. I was raised up in the church. You let it be your experience that I saw God for myself and he saved me. And I know that he saved me because I felt it in my soul. I know it in my heart that God saved me. Make sure you have that testimony. I want you to experience the goodness of God. And that's why I also encourage you to seek God for the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Seek God for the indwelling, the power of God, so you can experience him on another level. that you know that I have experienced God. You speak in an unknown language only to God. This is something I know I have God in me because I'm just communicating with him. I'm communing with him. That is something that God desires us to have. Amen? So let's make sure we tear up everything that is keeping us from God. These people in the Word of God, they tore up this roof. They tore it up. Now, I don't know if they knew the person in that house, but whether or not they knew him, I can imagine the house owner just looking at, what in the world? What is going on? They're just seeing stuff falling from the ceiling. What? There's an animal up there? Then they just, a big hole appears in a bed. Now, listen, this hole is big enough for them to let down a bed through. So they made a big hole in somebody's roof. They said, I don't care. I want my brother to be healed. And they let this guy down, and God and Jesus saw their faith. He saw their faith because of what they did. Faith is enacted. You can say as many times as you want, I believe, I believe, I believe. But the Word of God tells us that faith without action or faith without works is dead. We have to put actions behind what we believe. If I really want something from God, I'm going to seek him for it, and I'm not going to stop until I get it, because I want something from God. This issue that I have in my body that I need to be healed from, God, I know you're a healer. I'm going to continue to believe God. It's been years, but I know God is a healer. I've heard people testify that God is a healer. It's been so long. And the devil may say, well, you know it's not going to come now. It's been 5 years. I don't care how long it is. I know God is a healer. The Word of God says that this lady had suffered 12 years with an issue of blood. And there were people just surrounding Jesus. And she gets on her hands and knees in the press and just tries to reach the world of God. If I can just touch his clothes, ooh, I know I'm going to be healed. It's been 12 years. Ooh, if I can just touch him, I know I'm going to be healed. Oh, yeah. She didn't let them stop her. She didn't let the humiliation stop her. The humiliation. You getting on your hands and knees? That's humiliating. But the Word of God says, humble yourself under the hand of God. Humble yourself. I don't care what they care I look like. I don't care. I don't care what they feel about me. I don't care how they see me. I want God. Tear up your pride. They might think I'm a certain way. My friends might look at me funny. Who cares? Who cares? I want to go to heaven. And I want to experience heaven on earth. I don't care how you look at me. Young people, you don't care how somebody looks at you if you know that you're doing the will of God. Just like somebody who is hungry on the street, they may look at you, look at them getting something from sun. Ugh. Look at them. And are you going to care how somebody looks at you and you're about to get something from Sonic? Somebody may say, look at how they're looking at you. Mm. You know what? I'm just going to go hungry. That's all right. They just looked at me a certain way and it hurt my feelings. Man, take that on somewhere. I'm going to get me a burger from Sonic. And I'll get you one if you act right. Don't let anybody stop you from, look, feeling yourself. We're trying to fill us with God. And I said that to be humorous because you really, on the basic level, sometimes it can be so simple as your friend just looking at you a certain way. Mm. She goes to church. Mm-hmm. Look at her with her church shoes on. And she got on them. Look at her with her dress on. Mm. I don't like your dress. I don't like your shoes. It can be something similar like that. You think you go, look, your mom makes you go to church. I can play the video game at home. Let me even text you, where you going? I'm going to church. I'm playing the PS5. Okay, well, you play your PS5. I'm going to get something from God. Have fun. I know I'm going to enjoy myself. And look, hey, I know everybody is not on this level. But it's something for us to grow up in. That we don't have to look at how other people think of us and let that look and that feeling determine how we receive God. We don't let anybody or anything stop us from receiving God. We tear it up. And that's a decision you have to make. Okay? Somebody brings you, and look, it's as simple as this. Have you ever seen a TV show or a movie where somebody presents somebody with a contract and they don't agree with it? And what do? They bring contract up in the air and they just tear it up. Tear it up into little pieces. I'm not signing this contract. I'm not going to do it. Don't sign a contract with anything that prevents you from God. You tear it up. I'm not putting my signature on this. Tear it up. Somebody says, here, sign this contract and we're going to pay you $3 an hour on this job. And you're going to get started tomorrow. $3. It's not like, isn't it? What's the minimum wage? What's the minimum wage today? $7.25, is that what it is? Whatever it is, this below minimum wage and $3. You wanted to just say, wait a minute. Isn't this below minimum wage? Yes, but you can have as many hours as you want. You can work as many hours as you want for $3. You're like, what? Raise that contract up and tear it up into little bits and pieces. Amen. And so to use that humor, anything that is stopping you from receiving the fullness of God. Now, some of us have received from God. We've been blessed, but God wants to take us higher and higher and higher. We don't ever want to stop growing in God. Whatever we've received last year, that's last year. We're in this year now, and we want to receive more from God. Lord, I want to go higher in you, Lord. Higher in you. What you did for me last year, God, I thank you. But Lord, I want the more of you. I want the more of you, God. Use me for your glory. Use me for your kingdom. Use me, Lord. God, you've blessed me, but Lord, how can I bless somebody else? There's always so much more we can do. And sometimes, you know, looking at the Sunday school lesson this morning, the Sunday school lesson, we had a story called Forgetting the Past with the youth today. And sometimes we just need to tear up the past. Tear up the past and let the past stop controlling you. Tear it up and we just move on. The past it's in the past. It's gone. We can't change the past. We just move forward. Sometimes we made mistakes in the past, and we need to tear that up, tear up the hold on it. We can't change it. We can't forget about it, but we can change how it controls us. That's over with. That's done with. Lord, I'm moving forward. Tear it up. Somebody say, tear it up. Tear it up so we can get to God. My God, have your way. We want God to have his way in us. And the more we want God to move, the less of us there can be. You know, in Matthew chapter 10, I'm going to read something. Just occurred to me. I wanted to read this. Matthew chapter 10, and this is very important. Very important. Jesus is giving his disciples some direction. And he's giving them some things that he wants them to keep in mind. And this is something that Jesus said, and I remember years ago when I was younger, I read this, and I was like, wow. Jesus said, for I am, Matthew chapter 10, verse 34. He said, think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I am come not to send peace, but a sword. Now, we say Jesus is peace. We say that. But Jesus was telling his disciples, don't think I came in peace. He said, I came with a sword. And after that, he said, for I am come to set a man at variance against his father. And somebody's thinking, you came to set somebody against somebody, but listen to what the word of God says. And the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a man's foes shall he be of they of his own household. And then he said, and this is the truth, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. There will be some very close things, even people that you love dearly, that you have to make a decision. Am I going to love them or am I going to love God? Now, you can still love them, but you can't love them more than God. In other words, when it comes to us having to live for God and to make a decision to move further in God or to yield to this other person, we say, I'm choosing God. Because Jesus said, if you choose them, you're not worthy of me. And that is the blunt truth. If we choose anything over God, we are not worthy of him. We have to make the decision. I'm not going to let my feelings, I'm not going to let what is convenient for me keep me from God. And ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you that the pandemic made us all convenient. I was able to go home, chill on the couch, and watch service. Sometimes I might have been eating some wings while service was going on. Anybody eat wings during church? Does anybody bring wings in the church and eat them? Like, no, I can't bring wings in the church. But during the pandemic, we were able to eat, drink Kool-Aid, eat some wings while service was going on. They were like, ain't this nice? I'm watching the pastor on a big screen it's almost like we had a movie. I went to the concession stand, got some popcorn, some candy, like, pastor preaching today. Delicious. The pandemic made it convenient for us. And for some people, it's hard to get rid of that convenience. Like, oh man, I don't ever want this to change. This is nice. Woo, this is nice. I can go to Sunday school while I'm still in my pajamas? Oh, man. I can turn my screen off. They don't have to see me. Yes. Woo, this is nice. And look, I'm not trying to roast anybody. I'm roasting myself. I felt that way. It was nice. And listen, it's flesh. That's all it is. Flesh wants to do what's convenient for it. So it's fleshly, and we're all fleshly. So we've all gone through that temptation. But listen, now that we're able to come out amongst each other, listen, this is not to be forsaken. I can just say that. This is not for us to take for granted, us coming together. Coming together is something powerful, you all. It's powerful. It's powerful. When I can walk in here and see, you know, there was a time that I was just crying and I just said to myself, if I can just make it to the house of God. If I can just make it there, because I needed to see somebody. I needed to see some strength from somebody. I need some help. And you may not need anything, but you can be help for somebody when you come to the house of God. You just, somebody seeing you praising and worshiping the Lord can be help for them. This thing is powerful, you all. When it says don't forsake the assembly of yourselves, this is something powerful. And the devil knows that it's powerful. And now listen, the pandemic there was a purpose behind the pandemic. Because, you know, I look at it this way. You know, when the church in the book of Acts, when Paul came against the church, you know, Jesus had already told them to go and spread the gospel, go into Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth, and spread the gospel. But they were still in Jerusalem. But when Paul came against them and their lives was threatened, they started running. They scattered. But the word of God says that while they were scattered, they started ministering. They started witnessing while they were scattered. And I really do believe that the pandemic caused the church to scatter and it caused us to branch out, even on social media. We were able to branch out. So we were able to do that. But we don't want to forget the original cause of the original start. Amen. We still want to congregate, but we want to allow ourselves to still branch out, whether it be on virtual media or whether it be when we leave these four walls. Because we've been outside, we were outside of these four walls for so long, but we did not leave the gospel in these four walls, did we? Amen. We wanted to make sure that we let the gospel be shown outside of these four walls. So that's something that we want to continue doing. So in our convenience, we need to tear up our convenience. What seems convenient to us, we need to still press and make our way to the house of the Lord. Amen? Amen. Amen. So let's make sure that we get past ourselves. Not deal a lot with us, and us is a big problem. We are a big problem. Our flesh can be something else sometimes. Something else. You know, sometimes the word of God can cause us, tell us to minister to somebody else, and we may have the nerve where I just don't want to talk to them. I don't. And the word of God may be dealing with us to talk to them and minister to them. I don't want to talk to them. We can be in the way of somebody's soul being saved. We don't want to ever be like that. Amen. We don't ever want to be like that. So somebody say it again. Tear it up.
Tear it up.
Shout it loud. Say tear it up.
Tear it up.
Tear up whatever is stopping you from getting to God. God wants to move in your life in a mighty way. Every single person in this room, every single person that's watching us virtually, God wants to move in you in a mighty way. Yes, he wants to bless you, but he wants to enrich your life with him, so that somebody can see him in your life. Amen. Everybody stand on your feet, please. Stand on your feet. God is worthy. And everything that we do in the house of God is really to decrease ourselves. When we come into the house of the Lord, we want our focus and attention to be on him, not on anybody else. Yes, somebody else may look good over there to you. You may be single, they may be single, but that's not what we're thinking about when we come into the house of the Lord. You may say, well, Lord, give me an opportunity, but now it's your time. I give you praise, I give you glory. But Lord, give me an opportunity outside your house. But listen, we focus on the house of the Lord, how good God has been to us. Has God been good to you? Has he made a way for you? Has he touched you in your mind? Yes. God has done great things for us, and we are glad. Young people, will you please come to the altar? All of the young people in the house. Young adults as well, please come to the altar. Everybody up to the age of 25, please come to the altar, please. I said please twice, that's fine. Come to the altar. Up. Yes, yes, yes. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Don't you want to go? Come on, come on, come on. Don't you want to go? Come on, come on, come on. Don't you want to go? Yes, I want to go. All right. All right. Young people, young people, young people. And this is not just to the young people. I want to focus on you. God has something that he wants to do in your life. And he has something different and special for each and every one of you. Something that he has for you that he doesn't have for somebody else. It's for you specifically. And I don't want you all to forget that. When you get home and you have the opportunity and you have times where you can focus on God, focus on God. Focus on him. God has something great for you. And listen, young people, some of you may have been hurt. Some of you may have gone through some bad experiences in your life. But just like Joseph said, the devil may have meant it for my evil, but God meant it for my good. Joseph was a young man when his own family threw him in a pit and sold him to be a slave. But years later, Joseph was able to realize that God used his own struggle, what was supposed to be for his demise, for his death. God used it to glorify him, to build him up, and not just that, but somebody else's life was blessed because of that. So young people, lift your hands, and I want you to repeat after me. Dear Heavenly Father, and everybody, you can repeat this with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for your mercy. And Lord, right now, I ask that if there's anything in my life that is stopping me from receiving you, forgive me, Lord. And Lord, help me to tear up whatever it is that's keeping me from you. And Lord, right now, I yield myself as a sacrifice to you. Use me, Lord. Touch me, Lord. Clean me, Lord. And help me to live for you. Amen. Amen. Young people, the reason why we have you come to the altar years ago in the old Bible days, they always put their sacrifices on the altar to present to God. And we have brought that forth in today's time. This is what we use to present ourselves to God. And this applies to anybody at whatever age. You can come to the altar. And listen, the altar cannot just be here. It can be in your home. It can be in your vehicle. It can be at your school. Wherever you are, Lord, I yield myself as a sacrifice to you, holy, acceptable, and pleasing to you. Amen. All right, young people, you can return to your seats. Let's clap our hands for the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is good. God is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's say amen for our pastor as he comes.
Praise the Lord. Let's say amen again. Praise the Lord. We thank God for this very timely message on this morning. I was thinking about those men that were carrying this man on the stretcher. You know, somebody would have turned around when they got to the house, when they saw that there was no way in through the doors or through the windows. No way in. But you know, when you really want something from the Lord, you have to do a number of things. Praise the Lord. They looked around, there was no way. So they decided to take to the air. You know, there might be some difficult things that will confront you, but when you really want something from the Lord, you've got to go, praise the Lord, and not stop. Thank God, praise the Lord, for the message. And I was thinking about even when Herod killed James, praise the Lord, and he had intended to save Peter for after Easter. But something happened. And part of the message was speaking about coming to church. Coming to church. Well, they didn't have such a building, but the saints got together in Mary's home. And they began to petition God. They began to call on the name of the Lord. In other words, they poured out their soul. That was a corporate meeting of the church. So we need to have a corporate meeting from time to time in the church of God. For he said, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together as a matter of some is. Praise the Lord. But when you really want something from God, you got to press sometime. And many times you got to hold on. Somebody said, as Mr. said, it is never going to happen. But if you hold on, if you're persistent, if you stay with it, hallelujah. He said, tear it up, all the other stuff. Forget about all the other stuff and present yourself before God. Hallelujah. Somebody just lift those hands and tell God thank you. Out of your heart, just tell the Lord thank you. Oh, bless his name. Hallelujah. Thank God for you this morning. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but just hallelujah. Just standing here, hallelujah. 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 Anybody else feel his touch? Hallelujah. Feel a touch from God. Hallelujah. Come on, we thank God for you. We're looking very soon. The Lord said the same. Now, we're going to have a revival. The Lord said the same. But I don't want nobody here. I don't want you to stay at home. Praise the Lord. And when nobody's here but the preacher, I want you to come on out. It's time to come to the house of the Lord now. It's time to come. You may have many thoughts. Well, I don't say you, but those that are not here maybe may have many thoughts in the mind. But as the message said, sometimes when you have a long time, and you, as we have had, things go to sometime for some changing a little bit. You just get comfortable where you are. Some people feel like now I can just stay at home and listen to the service, but the word said, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as a matter of some is. Some have already done so, huh? Let's come on here and glorify God together. Praise the Lord. All right, it's offering time. I want you to get your offering in your hand. Those of you, praise the Lord, whatever offerings that you're giving, whether building fund or whether Sunday school, YPWW, or just a general offering or whatever offering. And if you have misgiving, if you have taken this time off and you're taking it off and not giving, praise the Lord, we need finances. We need finances. Praise the Lord. If you would get that offering in your hand right now, or if you need an envelope, and raise your hand. These brethren will give you one. All right. If you stand with us, everybody. Stand with us, everybody. Lord Jesus, we thank you today. We thank you for all things. We thank you for your word, oh God. And we thank you for these that are standing before you. We ask that you would touch every heart. Just let every soul know that giving is God's way. Giving is God's command. We are coming today, O God, giving as unto you. In the name of Jesus, we ask you to bless this offering and bless the givers. Let them suffer for nothing in Jesus' name. Thank God. Amen and amen.
We want to thank you for watching our service. Certainly, if you were blessed by the word of God, please like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube and Facebook channels. Also, to be a blessing to the ministry, you may do so by one of the following ways. Through Giblify, Jerusalem Temple, Church of God in Christ in Leland, Mississippi. Through PayPal at jtcogic@att.net. You may also use Cash App, $ Jerusalem Temple. Or you may mail your check or money order to P.O. Box 329, Leland, Mississippi 38756. God's richest blessing be upon you.
Come and connect with us through prayer, word, and fellowship. Join us for any or all of our virtual services Sundays at 11:15 a.m. Central Standard Time, on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock p.m. Central Standard Time, via Facebook Live or YouTube.
You know, something happens when we pray together. Morning Manna is here every Monday and Thursday from 8 a.m. to 9 a.m. with our very own pastor, Superintendent Roy Riley Sr., and also Monday through Saturday from 12 noon to 12:30 p.m. with the prayer team. Feel free to join in with us by calling 605-313-5086. The access code is 647-891-POUND. We ask that you would mute yourself and do not announce yourself on the call. Something happens when we come together for corporate prayer.
Let's study the Word of God. Every Sunday, we have prayer and Sunday school beginning at 9:30 a.m. until 10:30 a.m. YPWW, every Sunday night, 6 o'clock p.m. until 7 o'clock p.m. On every Tuesday night, Bible study from 7 o'clock p.m. until 8 o'clock p.m. Come and join us. We have adult classes via Zoom video. ID number 432-331-0618. Or if you choose to Zoom in via phone call, that number is 253-215-8782. Also with the ID number 432-331-0618-POUND. Again, we invite you to just come and let's study the Word of God, where we read, search, learn, and obey. We are just looking to connect with you.
You'd like to study the Word of God too. Join us on Zoom every Sunday morning, 9:30 to 10:30 p.m. and Sunday night from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. Wait, don't forget about Tuesday night Bible study at 7 p.m. till 8 p.m.
We also have a really fun time on Real Talk Interactive and would love for you to come join in on the fun. Sometimes we do Bible trivia and games, and other times we have great discussions on how the youth can stay connected to God.
We can't wait to welcome you when you come. See you there.
And to thee, O God, do we give thanks. Psalm 75:1.
Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him. Oh, fear the Lord, ye saints, but have no one to them that fear him. The lion do lack and suffer hunger. But they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. Come, ye children, hearken unto me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is he that desire life and live many days, that he may see good? Keep thy tongue from evil, and thy lips from speaking guile. Psalm 34:8-13.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Philippians 2:11. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the King of organs. Let him not be in you, but was also in Christ Jesus, who being the form of God, are not robbery, should be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of man. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also highly exalted him, and gave him a name which is above every name, God, I can name is Jesus, Dominique, about of kings in heaven, and kings in earth, and kings down the earth. And God, every time to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Philippians 2, 4:11. Philippians 4, 4:8. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your mind rightly be known unto all men, glory to him. Be careful for nothing, but everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. And the peace of God will pass all understanding, God keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, recognize things are true, recognize things are honest, recognize things are just, recognize things are pure, recognize things are lovely, recognize things are a good report. If there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on the things. Philippians 4, 4:8.